Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
This body to address the important issues facing this county. Please help guide us as we go through these decisions. Please help bring our county together as we solve the many challenges going ahead. We ask also that you be mindful and take care of our troops stationed all over the world, and that we can continue to work in the interest as you would have us. Amen. Amen. Let us stand. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you. At this time, we'll call the first October meeting, October 1st, the Alamance County Commissioners. Welcome to all of you. We appreciate your attendance. Glad to see so many people here tonight. For those of you that have not attended the meeting in a couple of months or so, we have changed the order slightly to where we do receive public comments prior to the approval of the agenda. We'll do that at this time. I have four folks that would like to speak tonight, and I'm going to call them in the order that they signed up. First is Mr. Ben Ansbacher. Mr. Ansbacher would like to talk about the decision-making process. Ben, welcome to you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you for this opportunity to speak. I'm not here to talk about the charges in the dispute between the sheriff and the DOJ. The sheriff is an imposing person, tall, handsome, in good shape, a good speaker, conscientious, and a good politician. He's very popular. Channel 2 News let off a story about Alamance County by saying, "The finger-pointing and name-calling continues." That damages our reputation. You have the power to put that behind us tonight. I would emphasize that you run the county and need not take orders from the sheriff. You do not need to pay for his legal bills if you see another way out. His priorities may be different from yours. He needs to fight crime and to look out for his reputation. You need to look out for the county's reputation and for the county budget. I hope in your meeting you will not spend time on the detail in your closed meeting, you will not spend time on the details of the two letters. Suffice to say, the DOJ have given an ultimatum, and the sheriff has said accepting the ultimatum is neither necessary or advisable. It may indeed be necessary if the fight is too costly, if you can't afford it. As to advisability, all you need to consider is what harm could come from the DOJ's 7 recommended changes. Recently, Bank of America announced an embarrassing $4.3 million settlement with the statement, quote, "Resolving this litigation removes uncertainty and risk and is in the best interest of our shareholders." As we work to put these long-standing issues behind us, our primary focus is on the future and serving our customers and clients. This did not admit any wrongdoing. Alamance County could craft a similar statement. If you decide to reject the ultimatum and pay the legal bills, I hope you will tell us why you could not live with the DOJ changes and how much money you will budget for the court fight. Thank you again.
Thank you, Ben.
If you like to make a copy of my remarks, or should I?
Yeah, you can give it over here to Tori if you'd like. This time I call on the second speaker, Mr. Steve Carter, would like to speak on law enforcement. Steve, welcome.
Thank you for the time. About 5 years ago, I was leaving a Christmas party one night, going down Church Street, and looked up in the rearview mirror and told my wife to brace herself because somebody was going to hit us. We got rear-ended. I stopped, got out, talked to the guy. He was inebriated. Police officers arrived. He had no identification. It turns out he was here illegally. No identification, no insurance. Now, you know who had to pay for that. I did. Nobody else. Not a big deal, but it's happening to a lot of other people. Our sheriff is enforcing the laws of the state, the county, the country. As he's enforcing those laws, he's doing that at the risk of being charged by somebody else for unfounded reasons. And I believe, and I think a lot of the citizens in Alamance County agree that those reasons and that the charges as rendered by the Department of Justice are unfounded. I think that the county needs to support our sheriff, and I hope that it will sustain its decisions to do so as they have in the past. Thank you.
Thanks, Steve. This time we'll call on Eddie Hsu. Eddie would like to talk about commissioner ethics. Welcome, Eddie.
Welcome. Thank you, Commissioner. Good, Mr. Chairman. Good evening, Commissioners. I sent y'all an email. Just a little blurb. Didn't think he was going along, made it pretty well known in that email that I didn't think he was going to agree with me. And Mr. Lashley, Commissioner Lashley, saw fit to write me back and say that before you advise with stupid advice, get the facts or something of that nature. I mean, that really makes me feel wanted and warm and fuzzy to come up here to commissioners meet. I was a little upset, Bill, but he may be right. I voted for him every time, and that might have been pretty stupid, and I'll try to remedy that. I will do my very best. Now, this morning, on WBAG, and this is much more serious, and I hope that maybe the commissioners will call and see that they will not put this on that streaming feed they have. Commissioner Sutton got up there and formed it as a question, said it would be illegal to talk about overthrowing the government, wouldn't it? And Myers told him, yes, it would, to talk about violently overthrowing the government. Now, he posed it as a question, but then he went on to call by name, and I hope I don't murder the gentleman's name, Mr. Asbacher, and Fairness Alamance. He called them by name and said he thought they was going to be here tonight, and the discussion in the closed session would involve the DOJ, and that he wanted some real patriots here to counter that. Now, people, that thing goes live tomorrow, and I truthfully, because if it goes live, I'm pulling it and putting it on YouTube, because that is against his oath to protect and defend this Constitution that he stands here and takes. If that's protecting the call for, he is part of that. If we're going to start overthrowing, maybe he ought to overthrow himself off the deck down here. How does that sound to people that ain't from that? To us, we're pretty used to it. I used to be jumping down people's throats, calling them commies and pinkos and this, that. I mean, we're used to it. But if that thing goes live tomorrow, which they generally do, it takes them a day or two, that's going to sound great out there in the world. And I expect better out of my commissioners. And I'm sorry I can't leave that checkbox empty come this day come November 2. Because I can't vote for some of these Democrats. So I don't break your hearts. But you leave me with no Republicans to vote for. Thank you.
Thank you, Eddie. Perfect timing. And last, Robert Boyer wants to talk about the commissioners and the DOJ. Robert, good evening, sir.
Good evening to you folks. I have a simple request. I just want you folks on the Board of Commissioners to accept the DOJ recommendations. Now, here's why. Regardless of how you feel about the sheriff and what he's done, I feel that it would be in the best interest of the commissioners to do this. Why, you may ask? Well, it's pretty simple. Maricopa County has spent millions defending Sheriff Joe Arpaio. And I'm pretty sure that the DOJ is pretty serious about this, and they're pretty serious about filing a lawsuit. Do I know that they will file a lawsuit? No, I don't. But I imagine they will. I doubt very seriously that they won't. So I think before we put ourselves at the risk of potentially spending millions of dollars, we should accept these recommendations and move forward. Alamance County is a wonderful place to live and work and raise a family. I moved back to Alamance County. I could have lived anywhere I wanted, and I moved back home because this is home to me. And it pains me to see what is happening to my home. And we're the butt of jokes. I mean, we've had derogatory stories written about us. And I just feel that it's in the best interest of the county to move forward, whether you like the recommendations or not, and just accept them and try to, I mean, what is the harm? I mean, really, what is the harm? But I can tell you that we've already had a lot of harm. We've already had a lot of negative press. And I just ask that you would consider that and move forward and accept those recommendations. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Robert. We have two periods for commissioner responses, comments. One does follow the public comment period, which would be now. So I would ask if any of the commissioners prior to the approval of the agenda would like to respond on anything that has been said so far.
Just spell my name correctly, will you do that? That's all I can say. Keep those cards and letters coming.
Okay, at this time, thank you. We will review and approve the agenda. This approval of the agenda would also include the items on the consent agenda schedule. You can see there are four items, including the minutes from our last meeting. Commissioners, are there any items on the consent agenda that you would like removed for discussion? Hearing none, Craig, do you have any changes to the agenda?
No, sir.
There are no changes or adjustments. We'll move for approval of the agenda as outlined in the sheet we have in front of us. Is there such a motion for approval?
So moved.
Thank you, Bill. Eddie, second. There's no discussion. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? The approval of the agenda is as stated. Moving to item 6, budget amendment number 30, telephone transfers. Susan Roberts is going to tell us about money and telephones.
I am. Good evening, commissioners. Before you tonight is a budget request to move $2,295.76 from our general fund to the emergency telephone system. Per general statute, the money has to be spent, and the expense was an ineligible expense, and we just need to correct that.
Any questions for Susan? Is there a motion that we approve that budget amendment? The amount is $2,295, is that right?
$2,295.76.
I move that we approve that.
Thank you, Eddie. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Care. Thank you, Susan. Next item is update on performance management goals. I'm going to introduce Brian Haygood. I guess you took over this responsibility recently.
I did.
Welcome.
I did. Thank you very much. I'm here tonight to bring you up to speed on the Alamance County Performance Management and Performance-Based Budgeting Initiative. This was a policy that the Board of Commissioners approved in April of this year. Basically, the policy, if you recall, had two major purposes. One was to ensure that county services were high quality, let the department set goals that would help them make sure that the service they provide are meeting the needs of the residents, and also to save money. It was one of the biggest reasons we adopted this policy, was to give departments incentives to save funds. Back in the 2011-12 fiscal year, we had six departments that volunteered to participate in kind of a pilot part of the program. These included the Department of Social Services, EMS, the GIS Department, the Library, the Facilities Department, and Recreation and Parks. This year, for the 2012-2013 fiscal year, all 23 departments in Alamance County government, these are the county departments, have all volunteered to participate in the performance management part, which is the part where departments set goals. Everybody this year is participating in the performance budgeting, which is the attempt to save money, but participating in the performance management part was voluntary, and I'm very pleased to report to the board that all departments, every department, volunteered to do so and has set goals. What they are doing currently is they've set goals per department, usually anywhere from three. Some departments have set three goals. Some have set, you know, many goals, 15 to 20 goals. They monitor their stated goals and then report the results to county management every month. Now, these goals that they have set, the success rate that they have with the goals, if you remember from the policy, has a bearing on how much money, if any, they're able to retain from their savings, which is the performance budgeting part of the program. If they meet certain percentages of their goals, they can save, retain a portion of the funds that they save throughout the fiscal year. These funds can be banked. They can be used for equipment, making improvements, buildings, and including bonuses for employees in the department. And what you have, what I've sent to all of you, is a copy of the goals for each department. There's a pretty comprehensive list. That was everything all the departments have put together. I didn't hear from anyone, but if you have any questions when I get through, I'll be happy to try to answer about the department goals. But it's important to remember, as I stated in my memo, no funds will be retained by any county department until the fund balance for county government has reached 12%. So once the county's fund balance reaches 12%, then departments that are participating in the goal setting part will be able to keep some portion of the money that they bank, not all of it. I believe it was 75%. At 12%. Now, once the county reaches a point in its fiscal health where the fund balance is at 15%, that's when county departments, excuse me, would be able to retain 100% of the money that they save, up to 8% of their total budgets. A lot of percentages in there. You guys remember, we kind of laid this out in the policy that you approved. The main thing to take away from this evening, we wanted to make sure that the board had a copy of everyone's goals, had a chance to look them over. I think you'll see that there were some very thoughtful ones put together by departments. They tried to focus on oftentimes what they thought were important services for the people that make use of their department and make sure those were goals that they were tracking. This is the first year for 17 of the departments, so it will be a learning year. There will be some goals that really may not work out the way the department heads thought, but that's okay. The first six departments went through the same thing, so it'll be a good learning year. And our plan is to, at the end of the fiscal year, come back to the board. I'll present you with a report to say kind of how the departments did, how these goals shook out, and hopefully the county will be in better financial health also. We may be able to, at some point in the near future, see some funds being able to be retained, but again, not until the county's fund balance is in a better place than it is now. So, you guys have had a chance to look over the goals. Do you have any questions about the program or any comments for me?
Very thoughtful. A lot of information.
And I do want to say I appreciate Brian stepping in. If you remember, Tim Burgess and Susan Roberts kind of head this up before Tim left us back in June. And Brian has stepped in and worked very well with Susan and kind of taken the bull by the horns, and appreciate the work that he's done in getting us to this point, especially in getting all 23 departments' goals together. It's been a challenge, but he did a great job getting them together.
And let me say, too, Craig, thank you, that Susan and Susan Roberts from Finance and Susan Osborne and Chuck Mancellus and Bruce Walker and MJ and Richard Hill, the folks that were the original six folks that volunteered last year, we made a little committee, reviewed goals, helped put together the policy. Some of them are here tonight, and I certainly appreciate their help, and they helped make it a program that other departments felt comfortable trying. So I think county residents will come out ahead based on the service goals, and the county government will come out ahead with the savings that we certainly hope to see. So
I got one question.
Yes, sir.
Registered deeds on there. I'm guessing Mr. Webster give you that. Respond to email inquiries within 2 business days.
I think they get a great deal of email in the Register of Deeds office, and one of his goals was to make sure that his staff reply timely. But
in today's electronic age, that doesn't sound real timely, but. Just curious.
Well, if you get 1,000 emails a day, it does.
Mm-hmm. Well, and this will be something that we'll try to do next year, too. We'd like to do is if you have, I would say, if the board or members have specific things they want departments to think about,
right.
It would be very helpful to the departments for you to tell us, for you to say, hey, we would like for you to focus on. Maybe, you've heard that, Recreation and Parks is not responding timely, or you have some concerns. It's a good thing to bring to the department head and say, could you somehow work this into the goals that you set for next year? I think that would be helpful to departments. This year they were kind of feeling around, and I think some of the departments wanted to they wanted to try to establish goals that they could attain to, you know, not so easy that it was a, you know, shooting fish in a barrel, but it was something that they could attain to.
Well, I guess what caught my eye with that one particular thing is, you know, when an attorney's trying to close something, he needs some information and can't seem to get it.
Yes, sir.
You know, sometimes it's timely.
But the individual department heads are the ones in this new group came up with this set of parameters and they met with your committee. That was my understanding.
The committee of the original six department heads, they helped shape the policy that the board approved. And then the departments themselves came up with their own goals. And the department heads and Susan and finance, everyone kind of sat down with the department heads and went over their goals with them and talked about the goals. I know Susan went on many of those meetings and met with each individual department head and said, okay, let's look at what you've set for your department. Can you achieve this? Do you feel comfortable trying to achieve this? Have you talked with your staff? You know, because I know, speaking for myself, for the Recreation Parks Department, you know, this was done in conjunction with staff. You have to sit down with your people and say, let's talk about, can we really achieve these things next year and what will push us a little bit.
And to get their buy-in.
Yes, sir.
Sure. My other question, and this is for Craig, you have this listed as an action item, but it's really an information item.
It is.
Right. Yes, sir.
Well, and I noticed that's going to be the case, I think, in the next one. Do we have a different cover sheet for action item versus information item? If you look back in your lead-in,
we don't. I guess that's why we didn't put a recommendation on. There's no recommendation on either one, but we can add a section that says for information only.
Well, I'd rather at the top where it says action agenda item. If you have action agenda item versus information item, and then we got to know. Okay. Any other questions for Brian? Thank you very much.
Thank you. Good luck.
Thanks.
All right. Thank you.
Next item on the agenda is discussion of the economic development incentive process, and it says I'm going to lead that discussion, but I'm really not. I'm going to, if Tim doesn't mind, I think you and I had a brief conversation after the last meeting when you had a conflict. You kind of wanted to bring up a couple of things about this policy, and the policy is attached. It follows the information here.
Yeah, I really don't have any formal comments to make, short of just stating that, you know, I've been concerned for years about how some of this, how some of the discussions are, how they're being held behind the scenes and who knows what when. And I think the thing that got me excited here the last few weeks was Craig calls on Friday and tells me kind of, and oh, by the way, forgive me, that's not your feeling of how it came across, but that's the way I took it. By the way, we're going to be meeting with XYZ to see if we can put together some type of agreement on something. And it took me by surprise. First, I'd heard about anything being worked out like that. And then it turns out it was in four publications Thursday, the Alamance News had the basic situation, in my opinion. The Rhinoceros Times had it. Greensboro News and Record had it on Saturday, and then I think the Burlington paper had it. And I find it odd that there's more. I think there's a lot out there that people know that not all the commissioners know. And I think we should be well versed on exactly what's going on, even if you think you're not going to have every vote or my vote or whose vote. I mean, this goes way back years ago where we had, in my opinion, you had a situation where we agreed on something in closed session. I don't think many of you were on the board then, but we agreed on something in closed session, and then it's my belief that down at the Chamber of Commerce, county manager and two commissioners go in and do throw more money upon the table without other commissioners knowing about it. And then there was a discrepancy about the closed session meetings as far as what money was mentioned back there versus recollections later. And we actually had a vote that came down for the closed session meetings on that particular issue, where of the three commissioners that were going to vote, the chairman said that the figure that was quoted in closed session meetings sounded a little high. It was $6 million versus $4 million. Said that his recollection of it was that the closed session minutes, the dollars mentioned, sounded high. The second commissioner said, I don't remember. And another commissioner that was no longer on our board that had been defeated in an election, he said, yes, I believe Tim's right, that that is not the figure. Now, we're talking millions of dollars. You know, we're not talking chump change. But nevertheless, the minutes came back out from the county manager, not you at the time, but another county manager, to still put in the figure that I was saying was not what took place. And the vote was 2-1 to go with those minutes, and I lost all that. But, you know, there just seems to be a better, more business-like fashion of doing this. You know, I think all the commissioners ought to be appraised on the issue at the same time. I think it's sad to pick up four publications and basically read what this is all about before I think we're all, at least all of us, are appraised on the issue. And I don't know how we do that. I mean, I think I know how I would like to do it. I don't know if we need to have a meeting every time one of these. I mean, I'd be willing to go to that meeting. We used to have Mac Williams come into a closed session with us and lay everything out on the table without telling who the company is and, you know, basically doing what we'd been doing for years. Now, he doesn't do that anymore for some reason. So, you know, I'm concerned about how we're doing things. You know, three commissioners or four or a county manager and one commissioner or a county manager and two commissioners, I don't think ought to be doing things without the rest of us knowing about it. And I think it's taking place. I think it's been taking place for years. And again, I just think we need to do something about it. I don't know how we do it. But again, I got the phone call on Friday when it was in two other publications in Greensboro on Thursday, which meant they would have had to have known about it on Wednesday. And for the, I mean, the latest on Wednesday for it to get in a Thursday publication. So again, Rhino had it, Alamance News had it on Thursday, the Greensboro paper had it, and the Burlington paper came out with it. And I get an, oh, by the way, phone call on Friday. We're getting ready to see if we can strike up this deal. There's something wrong about it, the process.
Were those publications actually, I mean,
Alamance was mentioned in...
I mean, were they speculations or were they actualities?
I can't really say that.
Because, yeah. I'm like you, Craig called Friday and said there might be a...
I think it was clear enough that there's a lot of discussion going on and that Alamance is clearly in the mix or was right. In the mix. Harold Owen was quoted. I don't have them here in front of me, but...
Yeah.
I think we deserve a... I think I deserve, even if I'm not going to vote for it, more than an oh, by the way, phone call. Because I'm not sure it would have come out in that conversation had it not, that, you know, progressed into something else.
Well, you mentioned to me two different issues. The latter issue you said is there one person that knows or two people that know and not the full board? I think in that particular situation, I think you and I talked about that. It was that day that we all heard about it.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think there was any advance notice on anybody's part. And I'm certainly okay, just speaking for myself, of going forward. If a county manager notifies one commissioner about something, that they notify all commissioners about something. I don't have any problem with that. And I don't have a problem.
And that's the way I've done it in the past. And Part of the issue is it at this point in any discussion, it had not required any county action. It was just a kind of more of an FYI. But when it started getting to the point where it may require county action, that's when I was letting the board know about it.
Well,
it's kind of.
And
I'll be more than happy to do what the board instructs me to. If you want to know about every project that comes down, the basic discussion, I'll be more than happy. But in the past, the way I've kind of handled things, and I'll be more than happy to change it, is when there is a project that it comes in and requests a quote-unquote incentive letter and a commitment, not a direct commitment, but the county starting to say this is getting a little bit more serious, that's when I've involved the board in the process. There are a lot of projects that come down the pike that never get to that level. So I will be more than happy, though, to, you know, if you want to be made aware of every project, I can do that as well. I just whatever the direction you'd like to give me.
Well, Well, and back again to what I said about the newspaper comments, I think they were more just speculations that people thought they knew what they knew.
Well, and let me just, to that point, Craig, and I've heard Mac's kind of presentation on this subject in general, and we also heard at the Economic Development Summit that was recently held at the Knodel Center, from the company standpoint, if too much information gets out too early, then they're going to go somewhere else. I mean, part of the reason that it is the nature of the confidentiality is a company doesn't necessarily want its competitors to know what it's doing.
Or if they have employees, yeah, exactly. And maybe you're going to lose a job somewhere else.
And I think we need to respect that. I think what you just said makes sense when it gets to the time, and you guys and ladies help me, but when it gets to the standpoint, if we're actually asked to commit funds.
Or not even to commit funds, but ask for we send out incentive letters, and I've done it from my office on behalf of the Board of Commissioners. We're interested in X project, win. And so, but that's when I call and I let the board be aware of what's being requested and give you a summary, and that an interest letter is being considered. But if you would like it sooner, I can do that as well. Again, I'm at your pleasure.
Well, I don't want to.
I don't want it any sooner until you have some.
Well, I think it's y'all do what you want. I just think it's sad that you read about it in a publication, four of them, before you really know from your county management or the board as a whole. That there's something going on. I don't think it should be done that way. I think I've said it before. Civic clubs would be run better. And I'm sorry. Again, you had four publications that was basically laying on the table what was going on before we even had a chance to discuss it. And it's like I told Craig when we talked, we might not as a whole want him over there trying to put together a group of people on a particular project. I mean, we have a right to discuss that. Even, if four of y'all or three of y'all want to vote for something, that's fine. But I think even the person who's going to vote no has a right to know what our management team is doing. Right.
I don't have any problem with that. That's what I said earlier.
How you do it, I don't know.
If you let everybody know or nobody know, that's fine. But I will say, I didn't see all the publications, Tim, that you're talking about. But we can't, as our board and our county staff, we can't keep Harold Owen, for instance, from talking to the paper.
No,
I think the first thing I asked you was Craig Honeycutt quoted in the paper? And you said no. So I think that's what our concern is. We don't want Craig feeding the speculation that may appear in the media.
It was clear, though, that he was going over to Mebane to try to put together this team, or to at least participate in putting the team together to see if there was any interest without us having discussed it. Now, and it was not a small potatoes deal. And I just believe it's the board, each member should be given the respect to have these things discussed in a more professional manner rather than an oh, by the way attitude about it, irregardless of what we might lose or how the chamber perceives it, how Mac Williams perceives it, and so forth. Again, I've seen deals where it was just down and dirty, and I just don't believe government should be down and dirty, even for jobs. So, whatever, if we can make it a little more
transparent.
Open, transparent. Yeah, I think we all come out winners. It's my personal opinion.
All right, thank you, Tim. I will say in the policy, I know this is nitpicky, but I'm looking at your other policy, and the last subheading is effect. You see that?
Yeah.
I think that should be an E, not an A.
No,
just throw that out. And again, this is something you had listed as an action item, but it really is just a discussion item. Is that correct?
It is. And I will be more than happy to sit down with the Mac and look at options of what's the best way and maybe present something back if that's agreeable. But again, I want to make sure you're in the loop. And one thing I do promise is if I let one know, y'all know. Yeah. You know, it's not something that I'll count my votes and go with the ones that I know that's going to vote.
Well, so. and that is what happened on Friday. I think Tim's concern is
right.
Maybe the way it was communicated was a little less formal.
And I can work on that as well.
Okay, very good.
I was in Pennsylvania, by the way.
Okay, next item on the agenda item, Jason's name here is here, but proposed historic preservation plan has Jessica Hill's name. Jessica, welcome.
Yes.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Chairman Manning, fellow commissioners. I'm here to present a request from the Historic Preservation Commission to receive consent from you to begin preparing a historic preservation plan. We have a slide. At this time, we're seeking a consensus and authorization to obtain estimates and research funding options for doing a preservation plan for the county. Kind of just a quick background. Historic preservation planning ensures that our valued heritage is protected and well managed for the benefit of future generations. It focuses on historic and cultural resources and establishes courses of action by setting priorities and identifying what is truly important. What is a preservation plan? It's a working document to identify historic and cultural resources at the county level and to consider the issues, problems, and opportunities associated with historic resources, and to develop goals, strategies, and actions for their appropriate use, conservation, preservation, and protection. The typical components of a preservation plan, there's a historical analysis. It's basically an overview of the county's history and its past preservation efforts. There's an identification of active efforts of outside agencies and groups. It also identifies a community vision for the future of the preservation planning. It sets goals that direct preservation efforts to attain that vision. It sets out strategies and actions that implement the goals and can be measured and evaluated. It also sets out a timeline for actions and deadlines of these goals. So the purpose is to preserve our valued heritage that the community deems important. It provides official recognition of these valued heritage sites. It creates benchmarks to measure a community's success of their goals. And it also creates a policy document that ensures decisions made today protect historic sites while providing flexibility in the future. Some funding options, I set out three. There's in-house, it would require staff time and the Historic Preservation Commission's time. The pros are that it doesn't require any other funding other than salaries and commissioner's time. The con is that it takes staff time and there's time constraints. There are a couple of grants that we can apply for. The county is a certified local government, so we can apply for what's called a CLG grant from the State Historic Preservation Office. It does require a 40% match. And there's also the National Trust for Historic Preservation. It is also a matching grant. Right now it requires a 50% match. The pro in this is that it frees up staff time and allows experts to formulate the plan. The con is that there is money involved. There is a hybrid approach. You can do in-house as well as a consultant. The pro is that you get the expertise of a consultant, but also the knowledge of local staff, and also it reduces the cost for just having a consultant prepare the plan. So, like I said before, the action requested is that we're seeking consensus from the board and authorization to research funding options and obtain estimates for doing a preservation plan. Staff will report back to the board with funding options and projected costs to obtain authorization to continue. And at this time, I can take questions. There's also members of the Historic Properties Commission here that would be happy to answer any questions.
Would you like to identify them
for us? I would. Who's our chairman? This is Brian Dalton, chairman of the Historic Properties Commission. Eric Richardson and Dr. Jim Bissett is over there. I think that was it.
Very good. So we have not had a historic plan. Is that
No, there are a couple sections in the land development plan and I think 2020 plan, but no set outline, just a couple of goals. I think there are maybe 5 bullet points.
Do we have a grant writer as such on either the county staff or in your group, someone that spends time specifically writing grants?
No. In the past, I've written grants, and I believe Jason has written grants in our office. I think each department writes their own grants.
We do have a lot of signs out now. I noticed one at the Harvard Museum, you know, about the railroad. So we do have a lot of signs in our county, which I just noticed it this week because I went down there and took a picture. So, but we do have a lot of signs, and that's a good thing.
Yeah, they important. They do a local marker program. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. We appreciate what y'all do.
And I'll make a motion.
Well, we're looking for, at this time, consensus. I'm not sure that's...
Is that what we're going
to
go with?
Consensus there? May be short of a full motion. I think Jessica would like to hear and her board that we allow them to move forward with their homework.
Yeah.
I don't know.
And come back with kind of the next step. Right. Is that okay with everybody?
Thank you.
Sure. There's your consensus.
I don't know where I was the other day, Eric. Where is Eric? I don't know where I was somewhere, and I was out of town, and I picked up those brochures on the Civil War trails, mm-hmm. if I'm not mistaken, and you opened up, and just all kind of dots in there for Alamance County.
Yeah. Got them, Civil War trails, everything.
I don't know where I was.
We actually were in a meeting this morning with the travel and tourism people from DCR, and they were talking about the fact that we actually have something in Alamance kind of like this.
Yeah. Lord knows Alamance battleground. I couldn't be proud of that.
That's what I'll
point at you. So I get to speak to you or not. But I love Alamance battleground and that whole area out there. Is just, we can't promote it enough. Yeah.
And by the way, Hall River has a museum.
Or too much, let me say that.
Hall River has a museum too, by the way. It's really good. And I'm on the board.
All right. Well, thank you for your time.
Yes, thank you. And thank you to members of the commission that joined us tonight as well.
Yeah.
Come back anytime. This time we'll entertain the county manager's report.
Nothing to update.
Nothing to update.
Nothing to update.
I would like to make a motion that we now go into closed session pursuant to North Carolina General Statute, Section 143.318.11A3. In order to preserve the attorney-client privilege between the county attorney and the Board of Commissioners, and receive a report regarding the claims made by the United States Department of Justice against Alamance County and the Sheriff of Alamance County. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Bill. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
We'll head into closed session.